Good evening, friends. Good evening, and welcome to the 11th annual Cranford Community Holocaust Day of Remembrance. My name is Reverend Cameron Overby, and I am the pastor of Cranford United Methodist Church, and I'm serving as the clergy council president for Cranford this year. And it is my honor to be your host once again, and a joy to be able to be together in person this year and not in an online venue. Although meaningful and wonderful it was, it is a joy to be in the same room together, and it is my honor to be your host as we do this most important work of reflection tonight. This evening's program is a joint venture among the Cranford Clergy Council, the Cranford Public Schools, St. Michael's School, and the Cranford Interfaith Human Relations Committee. For many years, each group had presented a separate program until it became one united community program in 2012. And we are honored and proud of this collaboration and are pleased to bring this program to our Cranford community. The symbol of tonight's service, as you'll note on the front of your programs and with the tours of the Daffodil Garden, is in fact the daffodil. And this alludes to Cranford School's participation in the Daffodil Project, which is a global initiative of planting 1.5 million flowers to remember the 1.5 million children killed during the Holocaust. Ms. Gabrielle Rendeck and students from Hillside Avenue School will talk more about the project and its significance during the Planting Seeds of Hope portion of our service. As we prepare ourselves, for tonight's remembrances and reflections, I'll invite us to all take a moment to gather ourselves, to undivide our attention from all of the things that run through our minds in a Wednesday in early May, and to be centered and to be fully present in this space. Our time together tonight will have moments that are somber and heavy. We are talking about the systemic incarceration and genocide of European Jews during the World War II era, and that is unfathomably terrible. And it is hard to believe that such an unequivocally evil system could be allowed to exist. Perhaps it's even harder for us to imagine that such a thing could ever happen again. But we must remember that the Holocaust was enabled by, among many things, hate-filled, dehumanizing, and divisive rhetoric that manipulated people's fears and uncertainties to vilify the Jewish people. Evil is rarely obvious to all of the parties involved in a moment, and we must actively resist this kind of hate-filled and dehumanizing rhetoric and action in our communities, in our country, and in our world. Our remembrance must spur us to action to ensure that we do not allow such atrocities to happen in our time and in our place. Thank you for being a part of this important work, for being a part of this important evening. May our common care for one another fill our hearts and move us to live lives for good and for light. We will begin tonight's service as we begin many of our times of gathering with the flag salute, and I'll invite Miss Talia Coffey, president of Cranford High School's Diversity Council, to lead us in the flag salute. Come on up. I'll invite you to stand in reverence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Talia, and thank you for your leadership in our high school. We appreciate you very much. Our service continues with a proclamation from the Township Committee. And here to deliver that proclamation is Cranford Mayor Kathleen Miller Prunty. We'll welcome her to the stage.
On behalf of the Cranford Township Committee, I want to share the proclamation that was read at our meeting on April 26th. Whereas the Holocaust was a systemic persecution and annihilation of Jews and other ideological and political groups by the Nazi regime and its collaborators between 1933 and 1945, where 6 million men, women, and children were murdered. And whereas the history of the Holocaust offers an opportunity to reflect on the moral responsibilities of individuals and societies and governments, and whereas we, the people of the township of Cranford, should always remember the terrible events of the Holocaust and remain vigilant against hatred, persecution, and tyranny, and whereas our global family, regardless of race, religion, or creed, should actively rededicate ourselves to the principles of individual freedom in a just society. Now, therefore, I, Kathleen Miller Prunty, Mayor of the Township of Cranford, pursuant to an act of Congress from October 7, 1980, do hereby honor the victims of the Holocaust and the survivors, as well as the rescuers, liberators, and proclaim that we as a community will work to promote human dignity and confront hate whenever and wherever it occurs. I am particularly honored to be here this evening when my friend Linda Leifer asked me, there she is, several months ago. Of course, the answer was yes. And I really am honored to lend my voice here this evening to remember the men, the women, the children who were victims of the most horrifying, irrational hatred. We also come together tonight to proclaim our commitment to speak out against evil, bigotry, anti-Semitism, because we know that silence only emboldens those with hatred in their hearts. 77 years have passed since Auschwitz was liberated, and yet towns and schools and public places around the country, sadly, even here in Cranford, have been violated with anti-Semitic words and act and symbols. These actions, this behavior, these words are not relegated to the history books. They are in today's headlines. Just a few days ago, I saw a woman interviewed on TV, and she said, "It's no longer safe to be Jewish in New York City." It is no longer safe to be Jewish in New York City in 2022. So just remembering is not enough. Remembering comes with responsibility, an enormous responsibility for all of us to stand up, stand together, and speak out with conviction to say, no more, not again, not here. If you will allow me the liberty to take some liberties with a poem by Martin Niemöller to make my point. First they came for gay, lesbian, and transgender Americans, and I said nothing, because that was not me. Then they came for Black, Asian, Hispanic, and Native Americans, and I said nothing, because that's not me. Then they came for Ukrainians, Mexicans, and Muslims, and still I said nothing, because that's not me. They came for Jews, and I said nothing, because I'm not Jewish. When they came for me, it was quiet. No one spoke up. So let us heed the words of Simon Wiesenthal. For your benefit, learn from our tragedy. It is not a written law that the next victims must be Jews. It can be other people. For evil to flourish, it requires good men to do nothing. So do not forget. Do not be silent. Let us start here. Let us start now and pledge that we will not tolerate anti-Semitism, racism, homophobia, and bigotry to survive in Cranford. We will not let hate win here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. For further opening remarks, I'll invite my friend and colleague, Rabbi Paul Kerbel from Temple Beth El Mechor Chaim, to give us some opening remarks and to introduce our candle lighting ceremony tonight. Rabbi Paul.
Good evening, everyone. Clearly, Mayor Prunty and I need to coordinate our speeches, because I was going to end with her, the words she just used of Pastor Niemöller, which is a poster from the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. Good evening, everyone. I just want to share with you three brief thoughts before we begin our candlelighting service. I want to share with you two experiences I've had in recent years. My first trip to Germany was in 2003, and I visited a concentration camp on that visit. I have now been to Germany 5 times and Poland and Czechoslovakia three times. And I have now visited 5 concentration camps. The first was in Germany, about an hour north of Berlin, Ravensbrück. Some of you may have heard of Ravensbrück. It is not known for having a lot of Jewish prisoners, but it was a women's camp. And anybody, any woman who spoke up against the Nazis from 30 different countries were sent to Ravensbrück, north of Berlin. And on our trip there, we took a train from Berlin to the town next to where the concentration camp was. We walked the 2 miles as if we were inmates being taken to the camp. We arrived at the camp, we were given a tour. It was Christmas time. And the concentration camp was on a beautiful lake. And on the other side of the lake is the town that we had just walked through. And we heard from the concentration camp side Christmas caroling, and it was about 2 weeks before Christmas. And the thought was chilling to me, because I was thinking to myself, was there Christmas caroling going on at the lake in 1941 and 42? And did the inmates hear the Christmas caroling? Did the people in the town know what was happening across the lake? And could the people in the concentration camp hear the joy and happiness that Christmas was bringing to people on the other side of the lake? On our way to the concentration camp, Ravensbrück, we stopped at a house where we were told a story. And the story is that the man who had lived in that house at that time was the butcher in town. And the Nazis came to him and said, we'd like you to supply meat for the, not for the inmates, but for the soldiers and the commandant of the concentration camp. You'll become a very wealthy man. And the comment of the man, the butcher, was, I do not know what's happening over there, but I don't want any part of it. And he resisted. That's a form of spiritual resistance that that man did in that time. Fast forward to my last trip to Germany, just 4 years ago. Next week it'll be 4 years. And we went to another concentration camp. We were arriving on a Monday morning in Munich, and the museums are closed. I said to my wife, Melissa, how would you like to spend our first moments in Germany going to Dachau? Because it was a half-hour train ride from our hotel into the suburbs to the very first concentration camp. It was a gift by Adolf Hitler to Heinrich Himmler, who was his chief of police and the head of the SS. Again, not for Jews originally, for all political prisoners. Anyone who spoke up against Nazism would be sent to Dachau. And as we walked around Dachau, which now has a church, it has a Jewish memorial, chills went through my mind that this was all before the World War II began. The steps were being laid. Concentration camps were being created. And unlike today, where we can turn on CNN when we go home and see what's happening in the Ukraine, horrible, terrible things. At that time, most of the world did not know what was happening in Ravensbrück or Dachau. And so I share this with you, having also been to Auschwitz 3 times and Treblinka once and Theresienstadt in the Czech Republic. I share this with you just to share the following. 6 million is a very large number. It's very hard for us to grasp 6 million people. I believe the state of New Jersey has 9 million people. So imagine if 2/3 of the people of the state just disappeared tomorrow, maybe from Bergen County, where our guest speaker lives, down to Princeton, maybe. 6 million people just disappear. That's the enormity of the Holocaust. But I'd like to suggest to you that the best way we can remember what happened during World War II is to learn the story of one child, to learn the story of one adult, religious or secular, it doesn't really matter, to learn the story of one town, one shtetl, which is the Yiddish word for the communities that Jews lived in around Eastern Europe, their own little, sometimes very mostly Jewish neighborhoods. Learn about one concentration camp or one ghetto. That is the way that we can begin to understand the enormity of what happened. But 6 million Jews died. And I just want to conclude by saying that yesterday morning I hosted a meeting for rabbis in New York and New Jersey through the Anti-Defamation League to learn about the audit of anti-Semitic events that is done every year. It was released last week. And to Mayor Prunty's point, the two states with the most number of anti-Semitic events in 2021 were New York at 416 and New Jersey at 370. The good news for us is that very few of them were in Union County. We are a caring community. We are a community that looks out for each other, that has a diversity committee that is working on, in so many ways, to bring our community together. But there's a lot of work to be done. Mayor Prunty said the beautiful words of Simon Wiesenthal. It's important for us to remember not just what happened to the Jews, but that it has happened again, and it continues to happen right now in the Ukraine, and all of us must be vigilant and work hard as a community to make our community an even better place than it already is. Thank you. It's my honor now to invite those who are leading the candle lighting ceremony to come forward. And we have 7 candles. And the question is, why 7? There were 6 million Jews, so at most Yom HaShoah programs, you have 6 candles. But the reason we have the 7 is represented by the daffodil. The daffodil represents the season that we are in, springtime. We just celebrated Easter and Passover, both of which has a symbol of an egg, both of which symbolizes rebirth and hope. The Jewish people always try to be a people where the glass is half full, not half empty. And I think for all of us, we are so hopeful that through the course that Mr. Vito teaches, that through the efforts of the Cranford Public Schools, that there is hope for our future, that the next generation will be able to treat each other maybe a little better than the previous generations and the current generations are. So at this time, I'd like to invite the following people to light the candle. Do we have someone helping with the lighting? Okay. Yes. I'd like to invite Mr. Kevin Deacon, the principal of the Hillside Avenue School, to light the first candle. For the second candle, we invite up Ms. Sandy Maragliata, the principal of the St. Michael School. For the third candle, we invite up Ms. Robin Marco, Cranford Interfaith Human Relations Committee. Our fourth candle will be lit by Lieutenant Matthew Nazaro, the division commander of the Cranford Police Department and Community Support Division, Services Division. For our fifth candle, we invite Yvette Andriola, the child of a Holocaust survivor. For our sixth candle, Reverend Dr. Deborah Brooks, who while living in Cranford for most of her life, is new in her position at St. Mark's AME Church and a member of our Cranford Clergy Council. And as our seat of hope, we invite up Andrew Ashenoff, Cranford High School class of 2022. May the light of these candles remind us of the power of light to dispel the darkness which has brought so much hatred and bigotry to our world.
Thank you to all of our candle lighters and to Rabbi Paul. It is my joy now to introduce Ms. Arielle Behrman, who will be presenting her work entitled A Third Generation Interview with My Grandparents. Arielle is the Anti-Defamation League's Director of Education of Programs and Products. In this role, Arielle leads the development and distribution of the ADL's signature education programs in the areas of anti-bias, Holocaust, and anti-Semitism education for grades K through 12, campus and workplace audiences. Arielle has been with the ADL for over 15 years, playing key roles in marketing and outreach efforts, program planning, online program development, and creating new partnerships. Arielle received her undergraduate degree in religion studies at Lehigh University with a focus on Holocaust history and education, and was a member of the committee that chose the very first Holocaust education chair at Lehigh. Arielle lives in New Jersey with her husband Adam, their three children, and two puppies, Moana and Zeus, and we welcome her to the podium.
Thank you so much. Can you all hear me? I feel like I need to put this down a tiny bit. Well, thank you all for having me. It's really so wonderful to join you all in this program and commemoration. Today, I am going to talk about my grandparents. My grandfather is no longer alive. My grandmother is still living, but they are both Holocaust survivors. And I want to share their story with you all today. So these are my grandparents, and I will be interviewing them. They both gave, my grandfather gave oral testimony. My grandmother wrote her testimony down in an unpublished book. But what I'm going to do is ask them questions, and they're going to be answering those questions in their own words. And so this really resonates with me. This is a quote by Elie Wiesel: when you listen to a witness, you become a witness. And so I feel like it's my responsibility, both personally and professionally, to pursue telling the stories of Holocaust survivors. And I always start with telling the story of my grandparents. So my first question is, where were you born? So this is my grandmother, Renata Wenglowitz. She was born in 1932 in Germany. And this is a picture of my grandmother when she was 6 years old. And these are my great-grandparents. I did a Google search and found these pictures of them. They are the parents of seven children. My grandfather is one of seven children born in Munkacs, Czechoslovakia. And my grandfather remembers the borders of his city changing all the time. It was a very global community. There were a lot of languages spoken because the borders kept changing, and now Munkacs is in Ukraine. So when was the first time you experienced anti-Semitism? We'll start with my grandmother. So my grandmother was very young, and one of her earliest memories were the events of the Kristallnacht pogrom. And she wrote in her testimony that she heard the sounds of glass shattering, red lights through her bedroom window, and a solemn family meeting in the dining room. She remembers sitting on her father's lap and hearing the tone of serious conversations all around her. And I'm going to ask the same question of my grandfather, who's going to tell you in his own words, when was the first time you experienced anti-Semitism?
So what was your first memory of anti-Semitism?
It was when somebody picked me up. That's the first showing of anti-Semitism.
How old?
Because I had pious, and that's and wearing a hat or kippah, and or a regular cap, not religious, but pig cap and other things that I was wearing, and even ended up wearing short pious instead of long one. But things always turned up bad, you know. So it's bad things.
I just want to make one note about this testimony. It was actually a group of middle school students who interviewed my grandfather and produced this video of him. So it's very special to me because now I have that. But it's students just like all of you who took that initiative and chose to hear a survivor and to share that story with others. So my next question is, were you ever in a concentration camp? And for my grandmother, the answer was no. My great-grandmother decided to send her children to safety in Great Britain on the Kinder transport. So the first Kinder transport arrived in England in December 1938, and the last one in 1940. Adults could not join their children, and the children were placed in foster families or in children's hostels. So in my grandmother's own words, what she remembers from the day she left on the train was, "Mother gives George a photograph of herself and gives me a bone brooch in the shape of a little dog and pins it to my coat. She kisses and hugs us, and we are on the train. The train is moving. Mother is waving. I think she is crying, but I am not. I don't know where we are going and why. That is the last time we saw our mother." So she left in 1939 when she was only 6 and a half years old. So for my grandfather, he had a very different experience and a different story. So my grandfather and his family were deported to Auschwitz on Passover in April of 1944. My grandfather, his brother, and one sister were selected for work. And after arriving in Auschwitz, my grandfather, Hershey, was sent to seven work camps. He was then sent to clean up after the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, and he was also sent to build new railroads in Dachau and Munich after the bombings there. My next question is, how did you survive? So for my grandmother, like I said, she was on the Kinder transport. She was sent from Germany to England. And most children on her transport and others, arrived in England with sponsors lined up and housing arrangements secured. One by one, the children in Renata's transport were sent off to their new homes, and only Renata and her brother, George, remained. The Anglo-Jewish committee did not want to split up brother and sister, but no one was willing to take two children. Ultimately, a family took George, and my grandmother was the only child remaining. The 6.5-year-old, Renata, remembers frantic phone calls, noise. She wrote that a local synagogue was called to find out if any of the members would take her temporarily. And a Mrs. DeLange, a volunteer at the train station with the Anglo-Jewish committee, agreed to take Renata for 2 weeks until a more permanent placement could be found. Her husband was not home to ask. She just brought my grandmother home. There was another child in the house. And Mr. DeLange came home to find another child there. Needless to say, these really beautiful people kept my grandmother into her teenage years when she then decided to move out of the house, but they were so wonderful to her and saved her life. And I also wanted to share this. This is a primary source that we just discovered when my grandfather passed away. My grandmother dug through her box of old documents and photos and found letters in German from her mother. We got these translated. She had not heard these letters since she was 6 years old. We got them translated. And so this is a letter from my great-grandmother to her daughter from Germany to England. How are you? Hopefully you are beautifully behaved there. Thank you for writing to me so beautifully. You have become very good at it. You even already have a bike and dolls, you wrote. I am glad that you like it there. I am thinking a lot about you. My dear mother, mommy, please continue to be well behaved and be greeted many times and kissed by your dear mom. My great-grandmother also wrote a letter to Renata's caretakers, the couple that saved her. I received your valued letter. I am delighted that you have written to me so nicely and that Renata is doing fine and that I can be unconcerned, but it is still very sad for me to be so alone. I received mail from George regularly, and I am glad that he is writing so beautifully. I will send him a package for his birthday and also something for Renata. I hope that Renata is healthy and remains with the best greetings. Yours, B. Wenglowitz. Hopefully you will delight me again soon with a few lines. So, you know, it's really so powerful, and we use this at ADL in our education programs to show, you know, these are human beings who really, you know, a mom and a child, right? And so many people can relate to that. So asking the same question of my grandfather, how did you survive? His story is really quite incredible. I'll give a little bit of a preface and then let him share in his own words. So in April 1945, rumors went around that the American army was getting closer. And so camp guards rounded the prisoners up and loaded them onto a train. A German military train pulled up next to the train full of prisoners in the hopes that the incoming air raid would not attack with a civilian train nearby. However, airplanes appeared and the shooting began. The prisoners were ordered off of the train with all of the commotion. My grandfather, his brother, and 12 other prisoners escaped into the forest together. After walking into the evening, the group fell asleep and were awoken by an SS officer who ordered them to walk to the nearby village. The officer left the group with the mayor and then went to round up more runaway prisoners. In fear of spreading typhoid fever to the town, the mayor sent my grandfather and the group away, advised them to walk towards the American army who would help them.
Us, you will exist, right? a good thing German is similar to Yiddish, so we understood them. We know that much, you know. And the Americans are this, so you walk that way to the Americans, they will take care of you. And he sent us away, he was happy we went away, so he shouldn't have the epidemic in his village. And about a half an hour away, still the end of the village, and we saw a house and then a big shed next to the house. And so we went into the shed and we hid there. I figured we have to rest. We come in there, we see there are lots of pigs in there, had animals, and the animals had old, loads of potatoes, cooked potatoes given for them to feed them. So we fed on the potatoes, at least, so we had to eat too. I was hiding in the shed there, and then eat potatoes. So one day, I the light goes on, I hear in Russian, "I got you, I got you." And then he goes, a woman, he goes, "Boże moi," like, "My God, it shows we are prisoners." So we knew some Russian, because this one of the languages that in my town, there are a lot of Russians living, we knew some Russian. So I started talking to her. She says, "Don't need this, I'll bring you nice soup and bread." And for 2-3 days she fed us, and I said, "We are 7 people, so she brought us food to eat. And then she says, "Americans came, and we know we are liberated." It's 2-3 days worth of excitement and all that we had, but anyway, we were liberated.
So this is, I always like to bring my great uncle, my grandfather's brother, Willie, into my stories because he never married, never had grandkids, but we were very close, and they spent, and this was so not typical of the experiences during the Holocaust, they spent every moment together. They never separated. They motivated each other to survive. They survived, and after the war, this is a picture of the two of them together. My grandfather, after trying to find some family in Europe, went to England. My grandmother, she left her home with the Delanges and went to a hostel for young girls. My grandfather and his friends, his fellow survivors, went to a hostel for boys. They had social events together. This is one of the pictures of them at the beach, and that is how my grandfather and my grandmother in the top right with the arrow met. They got married in England, and then they came to the U.S. And this is a picture of my grandparents in Florida with my oldest child. She's, you know, 1.5 here, but she's 8 now. And, you know, now they have 3 great-grandchildren to carry on their legacy. Thank you.
Thank you, Ariel, for sharing your family story and for presenting it so well. I now will invite Lara Marks and Jude Berglass, students at the Cranford from the Cranford High School Holocaust and Genocide Studies class, who are under the direction of Mr. Frank Vito. They'll be presenting Children of the Holocaust, a Historical Context.
Good evening. Jude and I are honored to be here with you tonight as representatives of Cranford High School's Holocaust and Genocide Studies program. Before we begin, we would like to turn your attention to the screen here on stage. As we provide historical context regarding the Holocaust's impact on children victims, you will see a series of images of art that was completed by children living in ghettos. We encourage you to reflect on these expressions of their experiences that highlight their past lives, treatment by the Nazi regime, and hopes for a better future. Their art allowed them to escape, even if momentarily, into another world. In this way, their art served as a form of resistance to the oppressive and brutal Nazi regime.
While the Holocaust attempted to rob all victims of their humanity, it was particularly appalling for children. After Jewish families were identified by the Nazi regime, there was an attempt to strip their property, rights, and privileges. For children, this meant the characteristics that ultimately defined childhood. Toys were taken, play was restricted, schools were closed. They were removed from their homes, and over time, friendships and families were broken apart. Parents face a particularly challenging and heartbreaking dilemma. Thousands of children survived because they were put into hiding. However, this was often only possible if parents were able to both find and then entrust their children to others, knowing they might never see their children again. When in hiding, children were often forced to abandon their identities, something particularly challenging during their formative years of development. Thus, survival often came at the cost of their true identity.
For children who survived, they faced a new set of challenges. Reunification with family members was rare. The adoption of new identities in an effort to survive made it difficult for them to search for their birth families, with many suffering feelings of abandonment, adding to the psychological scars they had to bear. However, the survival rate for children was significantly lower than that of adults. Only 6 to 11% of Europe's pre-war Jewish population served as compared with 33% of adults, according to the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. In total, historians estimate that 1.5 million children perished.
For children, there was an unfair and senseless loss of innocence that occurred as the Nazi regime robbed them of their childhood. Nevertheless, it is important to recognize the resilience that these children demonstrated despite the traumatic conditions they faced. Thank you.
Thank you, Jude and Laura. Good evening. My name is Gabrielle Rendeck, and I'm the supervisor of K-12 Social Studies for Cranford Public Schools. And I'm honored to be able to highlight a phenomenal project that has taken root in our school system, the Daffodil Project. How this project came to be in Cranford Public Schools is through a series of serendipitous events, beginning with English language arts students reading Hannah's Suitcase in the seventh grade. The story highlights Hannah Brady, a young Czechoslovakian girl who was taken from her home and sent to the Theresienstadt concentration camp and later Auschwitz. Hannah's artwork from Theresienstadt is actually highlighted on the screen. If you can go back one slide, we can see there. While the ELA teachers at Hillside Avenue School were teaching this text, Ms. Yvette Andriola, who was introduced earlier as one of our candlelighters, informed the team that her father, Alfred Glogauer, was in fact at Theresienstadt, the same camp Hannah Brady was in. Working together, Ms. Andriola and the ELA teachers were able to organize for Mr. Glogauer to speak to their classes, which proved to be a moving and defining experience for their students. However, they wanted to do more to honor the memory of child victims of the Holocaust. They discovered the Daffodil Project, which seeks to build a worldwide living memorial by planting one daffodil for each of the 1.5 million children who lost their lives in the Holocaust. This map highlights their progress thus far. Through a generous grant from the Cranford Fund for Excellence, 1,750 bulbs were purchased and later planted by seventh grade students in the Hillside Avenue courtyard as part of an interdisciplinary project led by the teachers on the team, many of whom are here today with us. Inspired by this series of events and the subsequent project, two Cranford High School students decided to create a film that told this incredible story. As such, it is my privilege to introduce tonight, brief even as bright, Remembrance Through the Daffodil Project, created and directed by CHS seniors Catherine Anton and Nathaniel Fasella, with faculty support from Mr. Justin Carraza.
Thank you. You wear this. This really? Clips onto your lapel.
My name is Teresa Mahansky, and I teach 7th grade reading and writing language arts. This is my second year at Hillside Avenue School, and it is my 13th year teaching.
Hi, my name is Ellen English. I've been at Hillside Avenue School for, I think, 29 years. I'm a middle school special ed teacher, and HAS is really a second home for me.
I am Yvette Andriola. I'm a speech-language therapist, and I've been here at HAS for 11 years, and I've been working for about 20 years.
How do you feel about the current level of Holocaust education in the curriculum?
They have an idea. They hear about it. They don't really know the causes or the why. So they had a really very general basic education.
I would agree. It has been somewhat limited, and once you start on the journey with the students learning about the Holocaust, they are so interested. We made this amazing connection, which really was the catalyst to really get this started. And the connection was that Miss Andriola shared that her dad was at the same ghetto that Hannah and George Grady were at from the book Hannah's Suitcase.
I believe Miss Davis had also heard about my dad, and she also was reading the book in her class, and she invited my dad.
Today we have a special guest joining us. I would like to welcome Mr. Alfred Blogart.
At that time, there was probably thousands. I was one of those. I was fortunate enough to survive. And what happened is a lot of those children, what happened is that a lot of times the trains were taking prisoners to various death camps. And a lot of those children wound up going to those death camps with their parents, to Treblinka and Auschwitz. Those are some of the camps.
A year ago, I was doing some research on the internet, and I came across the Daffodil Project, and I started reading about it. And the organization is located in Atlanta, and I started reading about this amazing project that people around the world were doing to honor the children who died during the Holocaust.
Well, it was something that we were trying to do across disciplines. So we were involving the math teacher, the social studies teacher, and the science teacher. So I think all the students kind of jumped on board.
Yeah, in a science class, which I have in 7th period, we were able to go out for one period, and we were able to dig and all plant all the daffodils in the ground in the courtyard.
Dug them, cleared out the courtyard, and planted them.
I think it's a great project, to remember all the children who have passed.
Yeah, I feel like you're honoring people who maybe not everyone knows who they are.
Upstander versus a bystander. We've talked about that.
I, from the side, say things, and it's It's like sometimes you don't know what to do. You don't know if you should speak, you shouldn't, because you don't know how other people is going to react to you.
Yeah. And we would hope that we can continue this project over time and build on it and hope to make service a part of it. What can you do for others? You know, what can you do to make the world a better place?
Can I be close to you? Be close to you. Ooh, ooh. Can I take you to a moment where the fields are painted gold and the trees are filled with memories of the feelings never told? The evening pulls the sun down, and the day is almost through. Oh, the whole world is sleeping, but my world is you. Can I be close to
I'd like to thank the student directors of Brief Even as Bright, Catherine and Nate. Your refined creativity and careful storytelling, you offered us a glimpse into how this important project took root in our Cranford community. Both students invested countless hours. This was completely extracurricular. If we could please give them a round of applause. Catherine, you want to stand? Moreover, I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the interdisciplinary work the HAS 7th grade team has done to develop a meaningful way for our students to honor the memory of child victims of the Holocaust. So our 7th grade team is here with us today as well. Thank you. However, this is only the beginning. As was mentioned in the documentary, the HAS 7th grade team intends to continue with this project, and Orange Avenue School will also be developing their own memorial garden next year. At this time, I would like to introduce Zornica Rusinov of Hillside Avenue School and Addison Bornstein and Kendall Toddings of Orange Avenue School. Zornica was involved in this year's daffodil planting project at HAS, and Addison and Kendall will be planting the first bulbs at OAS next year for Joseph Ghani and Zygmunt Adler, whose memory they will honor tonight.
Joseph Ghani was born in Greece in 1921. He and his family lived in Preveza, a small town on the shoreline with a history that dates back to antiquity. In fact, Joseph's Jewish ancestors had lived in Greece for thousands of years. Joseph attended Greek public school in Preveza, but also received a religious education with the other Jewish children who lived in his town. Joseph loved sports, especially soccer and baseball. In 1941, Germany invaded Greece and eventually took over the region where Joseph's town was located. The Jews of Preveza, including Joseph, were deported to Auschwitz in Poland in March 1944. There, Joseph was assigned to work in Birkenau as part of the Sonderkommando, a work unit that carted corpses to the crematoria. In October of 1944, Joseph and other Sonderkommando workers in the crematorium revolted, disarmed SS guards, and blew it up as a form of resistance in an attempt to assert their humanity. That same month, Joseph was killed in Birkenau at the age of 18.
Zygmunt Adler was born on July 18, 1936 in Belgium. He was 3 years old when the Germans occupied Belgium. 2 years later, the Germans deported his father for forced labor. After that, Zygmunt's stepmother left Belgium, giving Zygmunt to his uncle and aunt. When the Nazis began rounding up Jews in his town, some of his uncle's Catholic friends helped them get false papers that hid their Jewish identity and rented them a house in a nearby village. 2 years later, early one Sunday morning, the Gestapo came to the house. They suspected Jews were living there. Siegmund, his aunt, and two cousins were sent to a concentration camp, and then to Auschwitz, where 7-year-old Siegmund was gassed on May 24, 1944.
It is imperative that we continue to study the Holocaust and honor the memory of those who were victims of the brutal and senseless acts the Nazis committed. The 1,750 bulbs we planted in our courtyard garden at HAS and the continuation of this project at OAS is one way in which our community continues to honor the memory of those lost, especially child victims. I have before me daffodil bulbs from our HAS garden. I pass these bulbs on to you. As you break ground with the daffodil project next year at OAS, please plant these bulbs to honor the memory of Siegmund Adler and Joseph Gani.
As representatives of Orange Avenue School, we pledge to plant the bulbs as a part of a living memorial honoring the memory of child victims, as well as those who survived the Holocaust and went on to build new lives after this dark and difficult period. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Rendick, and and our students for just embodying so much of this cooperative spirit and the sharing of hope for all of us. We're really appreciative and inspired by your work together and your words and your actions. We will now have the reading of original poems from Miss Mary Castle's class at St. Michael's School. These poems, every year, the class at St. Michael's School will write original poems, and they select a couple to be shared with us tonight, so we're pleased to hear reflections and expressions of poetry from Miss Angela Navrosky and Connor Johnson. And the first poem we'll hear is Here We Are, and that is by Angela. So both of you come on up and have a share.
Here we are. Can you see me by the small rundown house, standing on the tall grass, remembering all the fun times I had? Can you see me sitting on the swing set, talking to my friends who died so old, unlike me? Can you see me by the museum with teary eyes as I remembered my family and my final goodbyes? There I am, on the ground, somewhere where I am surrounded by love that I thought would never be found. There I am, in the park, having fun on the grass with others who are kids at heart. There I am, looking up at the tourists, looking at how my family was and remembering our story. Here we are, having a chance to live again, being clothed in yellow, just like our star.
And the next poem is entitled A Field of Daffodils, and that's by Connor.
A field of daffodils under the shining sun are ripped from the ground that they've grown on for so long, brought somewhere new with no sunlight to grow, nor soil or water for their petals to bloom. Only a hard rocky surface where they are told to stay with nothing left but sadness and pain.
Thank you both for your powerful expressions and reflections. As we make some space for reflection, we've heard a lot today. Tonight, we are going to invite the Cranford High School Academy dancers to come and share with us a reflection of movement. Are you sure? Oh. I thought we were having a special guest. But they will share with us a reflection of movement, and we are in court, and excuse me. They are under the reflection of Miss Emily Donahue, and will perform Family Portrait, which is choreographed and performed by Teresa Hickey, Elena Michetti, and Lindsay Stevens, and Real Rokiki, who is unable to be with us tonight. So we'll invite them to share with us, and they'll invite us to reflect.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Friends, our time this evening is drawing to a close, but I do want to be sure to lift up the art exhibit that is on display in the hallway and the daffodil gardens that are, well, it's probably dark by now, but I'm sure you can have a look at as you leave this evening. The artists and contributors are listed on the back of your program, and your visit tonight would not be complete without taking in their creative reflection. Sometimes when words fail us, the expression of art or song or dance helps us to reach a deeper level of human expression. And we thank all of our contributors to tonight's service that have enabled us to reflect deeply and to remember vividly. I'd also like to lift up Ms. Linda Leifer, whose tireless efforts behind the scenes make this service and the collaboration it requires, which is quite significant when you get so many of different township people together, possible. As I have said, this is such an important cooperative service for us to come together as a community in all of its different parts to support. It's not just for our Jewish neighbors, but for any and all who find themselves in marginalized positions. And on a personal note, as some of you know, this is my last service with you as a pastor in Cranford, New Jersey, as I've been appointed to the United Methodist Church in Red Bank starting in July. The spirit of this service and the interdisciplinary cooperation of Cranford is something that I will take with me and hope to instill in every community that I am a part of. So thank you, personally, for allowing me to be your neighbor, your colleague, and your friend over these last 8 years, and the president of the clergy council the last three. So, speaking of colleagues and friends, I will now invite Dr. Scott Rubin, the superintendent of Cranford Public Schools, for some closing remarks.
Can we please just give another round of applause for all of our participants here this evening? It is just so incredibly powerful to have all of these community partners come together and speak in one voice. And so we really appreciate all of their presentations, their participation, and their words. Once again, I'd just like to acknowledge also the Cranford Clergy Council, the Interfaith Human Relations Committee, St. Michael's School, for this incredibly special community collaboration that continues to grow every single year. And I also, too, would like to thank Gabby Rendeck and Linda Leifer for all of their efforts, the students, administration, faculty, all of our community partners for their contributions in this most important event. So let's give them another round of applause, please. And also a very special thank you to Reverend Overby for all of his years of service to Cranford, for being the master of ceremonies here tonight. As he also stated, he'll be leaving us, sadly, he'll be leaving us soon. We certainly wish him very well in this next chapter, but he will sorely be missed here. And so let's give him a very nice round of applause. And lastly, I just want to thank each and every one of you for your attendance here this evening. I also want to thank everyone who will see this presentation on TV 35 or online. It truly is up to each and every one of us to continue to plant and cultivate the seeds of hope that will ensure the bloom of a bright tomorrow for everyone. Thank you all for coming tonight, and have a good evening.